All right. Well, welcome. Hello again. And thank you for joining us today. I'm Bob Continetti, Senior Associate Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, and I'll be your moderator for this faculty town hall. Once again, we're going to have a group of panelists to provide some updates on our operations during the COVID-19 pandemic and to answer your questions. Some questions were submitted during registration, but I encourage everybody to feel free to use the question and answer Q&A window on Zoom to submit additional questions for our panelists during the town hall. Due to our time limitations, we'll not be able to get to all of your questions, but we will log the questions as they come in and post the answers on the Return to Learn website. And the link to that should be showing up. This webinar today has live closed captioning available in two ways. First, you can click on the closed caption button at the bottom of the screen and select show subtitles, or you can also click on the link that is now being pasted into the chat. Now, with no further ado, I'd like to introduce our Chancellor, Pradeep Khosla, for some welcoming remarks. Chancellor Khosla.
Bob, thank you very much, sir. Good afternoon and welcome everybody. After a very, very long time and for a change, I come here bearing some very good news for all of us today. So I'm hoping that my comments to you all will be more positive across the board than you've ever seen before. And by the way, this is close to a 1 year anniversary of when we first decided to send our students home and go remote overnight. First of all, we are seeing far fewer positive cases on campus, and you'll hear more about this. We have moved from tracking the number of positive results each day, we're still doing that, to tracking the number of days without a positive result. And this is actually good news. Positive cases in the county, as you've been watching or reading the newspapers, have also gone down. And we expect San Diego County in the very near future, sometime as soon as the end of this week or early next week, to move into the red tier. And then the restrictions will begin to relax. And this is where we need to be careful. Here on campus, as we have done before, we will continue to look to the science and to our in-house experts for guidance. Our science and our experts have done an extremely good job of helping us managing this pandemic. We will consider what's best for our community before making adjustments to protocols or safety operations. The county, as you know, has opened up phase 1B vaccination, and the state also has identified educational institutions or educational workers as a priority for vaccination right now. So we are basing our prioritization on what we have seen from the state. So here's where the good news starts. All employees on our campus will receive invitations for vaccinations. To ensure that the most vulnerable of our community are vaccinated first, we have developed a vaccination prioritization plan. And this plan is developed by our doctors, our faculty from public health, our faculty from campus. So there's a lot of input into this, and I think it has been going really well. So in our stage approach, all employees who are eligible will be invited to schedule an appointment at REMAC through my chart. So let me start with what's happening right now. So first of all, every faculty member will receive an invitation. And here's my latest information. All faculty have been invited, and all academic research students have been invited. All graduate students and fellowships have been invited today. So if you think you should have been invited or your students should have been invited and you're not, please send an email and fill out a form, rtl@ucsd.edu. That is a place that's the place where you need to send your issue, and then there will be people in the background who will resolve the issue. So today, 51% of campus employees have been vaccinated. 68% of campus academic senate employees have been vaccinated. 68% of campus academic senate members, not employees, have been vaccinated. 62% of health academic senate members have been vaccinated. So you can see there's a whole lot of momentum out here behind our vaccination plan. And for this vaccination plan, I want to say a big thank you to the leadership of Patty Bassett, the CEO of our hospital, and also to the committee that has been prioritizing this. I think across all the UCs, we are yet one more time a leader in vaccinating our people before other people are vaccinating, because our people have been vaccinating San Diego County, people living in San Diego County through Petco Park. Okay, so that's where we are. Sometime by the end of this week or next week, early next week, we'll send out a memo about fall quarter opening. And I can tell you, we're all looking forward to an opening which would be more in person than not. We will also be sending out a memo on what the graduation is gonna look like. It seems that the governor is gonna opine on, or the governor's office is gonna give some guidance on what the graduation is gonna look like. So we are in conversation with the provost and the deans to look at what the graduation is gonna look like. So in the next week or two, there's gonna be several announcements coming out, all positive, I hope. And again, thank you very much for being part of this community, for really supporting the community, and for supporting our students. So back to you, Bob, sir.
Well, thank you for that good news, Chancellor Khosla. Now I would like to welcome the host of today's town hall, UC San Diego Executive Vice Chancellor, Elizabeth Simmons. Elizabeth.
Thanks very much, Bob. Well, as Chancellor Khosla remarked, it's been 1 year since we transitioned abruptly to the remote learning environment, a change that we had hoped would just be a temporary disruption for a few weeks or months. But here we are, and I'd like to thank all of you, our faculty, for your ongoing support of the university community, because your flexibility, your compassion for your students, and your overall commitment to supporting fellow Tritons have enabled us to uphold our research standards, our educational standards, and our service mission through this tumultuous time. Well, remote instruction was a largely unfamiliar educational model for our university a year ago, and the experience of the past year has presented various challenges. But as we heard from many of our colleagues at the Educational Innovation Expo last week, it has also offered some benefits for educators and students and revealed opportunities to improve the way that we educate and give access to diverse learners. Exploring these opportunities as we go forward will not only allow us to continue, but indeed strengthen the way we serve our university community so that all of our faculty, staff, and students can succeed and thrive here at UC San Diego. It's a great pleasure to join today's town hall as we discuss the latest developments in response to the pandemic. We'll hear about the improving county situation and the wider range of vaccination plans. We'll hear about plans for spring break, information on maintaining and enhancing our research presence. And I just wanted to pick up a little bit on what the Chancellor alluded to about fall. Our aspirations are for a relatively more traditional looking fall, with students and faculty expected to be back in residence again, teaching returns to predominantly in-person and synchronous, of course, with accommodation being made for individuals with special situations. And because fall course scheduling happens now, to preserve all of our options, and in particular, the option to have an in-person fall, we'll build the fall schedule as in-person, because that gives us the greatest range of flexibility overall. That will allow us to do in-person teaching in the fall if the county health guidelines in the fall permit that to happen. And in the meantime, there will be plenty of opportunity to make any necessary adjustments as the science and the county guidelines dictate. Of course, we'll have backup options for fall, including a readiness to pivot remote, if that's what the county requires of us. And of course, including maintaining our outdoor teaching spaces for anybody who would like to use them in fall. Well, I look forward to continuing conversations with you and with everybody on campus about prospects for our post-pandemic future. But now I'd like to turn the floor over to my colleague, Senate Chair Stephen Constable, who will say a few words before we move on to the rest of the program. Steve?
Thank you, Elizabeth, and hello, everybody. I'd like to elaborate a little on what EVC Simmons has just described for the fall. Even though fall quarter is over 6 months away and the class schedules are being made at this time. And as we will hear today, the vaccination rollout, along with falling numbers of COVID cases, makes it most likely that by fall, everybody who wants vaccination will be able to get it and at last resume predominantly in-person teaching. However, fall is a long way away. We're still working under a prohibition on indoor teaching, and so it's going to be a while before we have full clarity on what fall quarter will look like. Some faculty are developing R courses in order to provide flexibility in the fall, which is fine, but R courses are not a good tool for delivering emergency remote instruction, should that be necessary as we get closer to fall quarter. R courses require careful development in consultation with the Teaching Plus Learning Commons and need to be approved by the Senate. They are, in short, a lot of work to do properly and deliver properly. So the Academic Senate supports the idea that we will be mostly back in person teaching in the fall, but is prepared to provide exceptions to remote instruction as needed. Our advice is prepare for in-person teaching, but be assured that the Senate will provide the exceptions necessary where in-person teaching is not advisable. With that, thank you. I will pass it back to Bob.
Thank you, Dr. Constable. So as has been mentioned, this week marks the 1 year anniversary of the cross-campus response to COVID-19. So as we reflect back on the past year, today we're gonna get a bit more interactive and ask three questions of you during these presentations using the polling function of Zoom. The polls will appear on your screen and you'll make a selection, and please remember to click the submit button. So we're gonna start with our first question now. And that question is, overall, I am satisfied with how my university is responding, managing the COVID-19 crisis. To answer, as you can see, you will choose from a scale of very satisfied to very unsatisfied. So if we can please go ahead and fill that in. Looking back from my own perspective over the last year, it's really been a marathon of crisis management, a year of relentless challenges, and not just the COVID-19 pandemic. We were challenged by confronting racism in our society, coupled with one of the most chaotic political environments in our history. Yet we've gotten through it together, and I'm proud of that. Well, perhaps everybody's had a chance to make their selection. Great, let's take a look at the results. And we really appreciate that feedback. Thank you. Now I'd like to move on to introduce our first presenters today, Dr. Chip Schooley, Professor of Medicine, and Dr. Natasha Martin, Associate Professor of Medicine. They're going to update us on the state of the pandemic, the vaccine rollout, and provide us with information regarding public health predictions and the modeling outlook for fall 21. Dr. Martin.
Good afternoon, everybody. So I will talk a little bit about where we are in terms of the pandemic. Here you can see the daily new confirmed cases in the United States, which as you know, has been declining since our surge over in the Christmas and New Year period. But there have been concerns that the rate of decline has been slowing. So as you can see on the right-hand side of this figure, you know, that the curve is not nearly as steep in terms of the drop of the cases. And there is concern that as some settings start to reopen, that we may see a potential second surge. So we're monitoring that closely. Next slide, please. The situation in San Diego mirrors that in the state as well as the country in terms of our continued declines in case rates. It's that case rate measure in the top left that is what's keeping us in the purple tier. This slide's showing it at 10.8 cases per 100,000 individuals per day. We actually just got our revised case rate just a few hours ago, and that has gone down further to 8.8 per 100,000 per day. And just putting that in context of we're looking for a number below at or below 7 in order to be able to proceed into the red tier. But based on the recent continued declines in cases and the fact that this case rate is a lagged measure, we anticipate that to occur in the near future. Next slide, please. So the situation on campus continues to improve. And you can see here on the left-hand slide that we continue to do between 1,500 and 2,500 tests per day among our students. And in the center, you can see that the number of cases diagnosed continues to decline. And in the last week, we've had, you know, between 0, 1, or 2 cases per day. Total in the last 7 days, we've had 5 student cases of students residing on campus, 2 students residing off campus. And we've also seen a dramatic decline in the amount of activity among our campus employees, showing here on the right, we are testing about 500 employees per day, and most days have 0 cases. In the last week, we've only had 1 campus employee case. So the situation really quite stable and good at the university level. Next slide, please. We also continue our ambitious wastewater monitoring program. We currently have 115 wastewater samplers, which are monitoring sewage from over 300 buildings on campus every day. The information is provided on our public daily dashboard. And what we've learned over the course of this year is that the wastewater is highly sensitive. So over 85% of our individual cases that we detected in residences were associated with a positive wastewater signal. And so that it provides us an early warning in terms of infections in those buildings. And the notifications themselves and a receipt of knowing that your building is positive is associated with increased testing and roughly doubles testing in the days after the notification. So that's all good news. Next slide. And what you can see here, these are the actual wastewater results per day. So every column, every row is a wastewater sampler, and every column is a day. And the green is a negative sample, the red is a positive sample, and the white is where we weren't able to collect a sample. It was clogged, the battery ran out. But what you can see here in the black square is that over the month of our winter moving period in January, quite a lot of our samplers, over half of our samplers on any given day were positive. But that has tailed off quite dramatically over on the right-hand side, as you can see here, where, you know, in the past week, we've been having maybe 5 to 8 of our residential samplers positive, you know, less than 10%, corresponding with the decrease in cases that we're seeing on campus. So supporting the situation, kind of improving campus-wide. Next slide, please. One of the other things that we're tracking very closely is the spread of variants of concern. Christian Anderson's team has been looking across the United States where the particular variant here on the slide, the B1.1.7 variant first identified in the UK, has been really identified across the United States and is expanding in terms of the proportion of cases that are attributable to this variant, increasing across states and in California as well, and is something that we're concerned about because of the increased transmissibility of this variant, as well as the increase in morbidity. Next slide, please. And so we're tracking the situation on campus. One of the things we can do now is we are sequencing both individual samples as well as the wastewater samples to be able to identify what variants are present and circulating on campus. This shows a kind of subtree of the samples that we've sequenced here among the students. I mean, if you go to the next slide, please. One of the things we can do is color these trees to identify which variants are circulating. And so here the blue is sort of the non-California variants, and the red is indicating the two variants that make up the California lineage. And so you can see here that we're able to track the presence of variants on campus. And so we now really have robust surveillance tools to look for variants. And in tandem with our increased wastewater coverage, as well as the sequencing of both the wastewater and the individual samplers, are really in a good place in order to robustly monitor the progression of variants and situation on campus moving forward. And now I'll turn it to Chip, who will talk a little bit about vaccinations.
Sure, we're beginning to see the momentum picking up a bit in terms of vaccination nationwide. We've had a slow couple of weeks, both because of storms and also because of some shortages in supplies. But over the next few weeks, we expect things to pick up. As you know, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine was approved by the FDA last week, and J&J is beginning to ship their vaccine around the country. We have some here in San Diego and indeed at UC San Diego Health. It's a nice vaccine because it's been given in a single injection and doesn't require as much difficulty with the cold chain. I think that coupled with increasing availability of the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines is going to really help us begin to make a bigger dent in the unvaccinated population. As you can see, California is in the kind of upper mid-tier for where we are compared to the rest of the country. We've at least 18% of California natives have gotten one dose, and not quite 10% have received two doses. So we're moving the right direction. Next. Now, what's going on here is, as you know, we've had a superstation at Petco Park, which has been running. The hospital set that up now, 2 months ago. And it has really done a fantastic job in terms of vaccinating people, vaccinating along with what we've done on campus. We are the number one UC and all the system for vaccinating people, and are really pleased to see that. These sites are going to remain open. Petco may have to move when the Padres get here. That's still under discussion. But the tempo is limited only by the availability of vaccines. And the hospital has begun to operate some mobile vans, which will help us to give to populations that can't get to the two fixed sites. The Moderna vaccine shortfall continues. We've had a large population of people who received the first dose just before the shortages began and are waiting to get the second dose. As I think you've probably heard from a number of sources, the 3 and 4 week intervals between first and second vaccinations for the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines, respectively, were arbitrary time courses that were established in the clinical trials in an effort to do this as quickly as possible. If this had not been a public health emergency, it's likely they would have spaced those two vaccinations out a bit further, because in other vaccines that are given sequentially a little bit further out gives you a better booster effect. But in any case, we don't think there will be any long-term loss by being delayed a few weeks on the second vaccination. In fact, there may be a longer-term gain. The way the hospital is handling this is that people are being scheduled as vaccines available, and vaccine that is predicted to get here doesn't always show up. So if on the day you're supposed to be vaccinated, the vaccine shipment doesn't show up, you're then canceled and they kick you forward to the next vaccine availability. And what the approach has been is to vaccinate people in the order of their first vaccination, so that we're trying to kind of get the people who have the longest lag first. If you haven't gotten a notification, you think you've gotten lost in the shuffle, on the RTL website, there is a banner that has a radio button, and you can fill out the form that Dr. Khosla mentioned that will help you get the attention of people who can look up your name in particulars and figure out what's going on. That website was just posted in the chat. I mentioned the Johnson & Johnson vaccine has arrived. It's going to be, we'll begin to use it some next week. Not large amounts of it yet. Next. Now, on March 15th, the county is going to open vaccinations to people under the age of 65 who have one of a number of predefined pre-existing conditions. Next. Now, these conditions are very clearly laid out here. They include, as you'll see, cancer, chronic kidney disease, and so forth. And in addition, people who have developmental or disabilities that make it difficult to get to COVID care are all included on this list. The list isn't perfect. One could argue that some of these should be higher up in the priority list. Some people may have been left off that were not included, but the effort here was to get things that seemed to be the most concerning without making it so complicated it couldn't be managed. Next. Now, the way this will work is those of you who get your healthcare at UC San Diego will have these conditions are in your Epic record, and you'll receive a notification that an invitation to be vaccinated, a ticket, and you go through my chart and make an appointment like everyone else has been on the age-based and employment-based approach over the last couple of months. If for some reason you don't receive a notification, again, use the same procedure that we've talked about. Go to the RTL banner, punch the radio button, and enter your information. If you get your care elsewhere, they will have an analogous process so that you can get your vaccine through that program as well. Next. So we are done at this point. I see some questions that have come in. We'll address them later.
Thank you, Drs. Martin and Schooley, for your guidance and leadership today and over the past year in helping the university navigate these incredible challenges. And if you could just stay with me for a moment for the next poll question, let's move on to that. As we consider the past year, we'd like to get your opinion on how satisfied you are with the level of communication surrounding our response to the COVID-19 crisis. As you can see in the window, the poll question is, I am satisfied with the university's level of communication, e.g. frequency, timeliness, breadth, about the COVID-19 crisis with a graded set of very unsatisfied to very satisfied. So please go ahead and fill that out. And then, but I was actually wondering, Dr. Martin, if you're on the line still, I was wondering, the deployment of the wastewater monitoring has been interesting to watch as a really a rapidly developing research project. Do you think wastewater monitoring is going to be a widely deployed public health measure even after the pandemic has subsided?
I do. I mean, it's been used even before COVID in terms of monitoring, for example, polio eradication. And I think that it has received increased visibility and interest through COVID. I think it's going to be particularly useful in the fall as cases decline and people are vaccinated to really, again, provide that very sensitive signal in terms of where we might see cases. And moving forward, I think we will think about brainstorm other ways in terms of how we can use it to monitor other infectious diseases as well.
All right, well, thank you. And I think we're ready for the results. Thank you. Very satisfied is dominating. So we appreciate that. And we'll take it, we'll examine those later as we figure out how to proceed in improving our communication. So next we're gonna hear from Vice Chancellor for Student Affairs, Allison Satterland. And as this slide shows, she's gonna tell us about plans for a safe spring break.
Allison. Thanks, Bob. Thank you so much. So I believe I shared some of this information with you all in a prior town hall. So I'm really happy to be back with some more specifics that, you know, in support of our efforts to reduce the spread of the virus that causes COVID-19, our return to learn efforts included the development of a Stay Safer, Stay Put spring break initiative. So starting the evening of March 20th, we will host a series of on-campus activities, masked, outdoors, and in groups no larger than three to encourage our students living in campus operated housing to stay with us during spring break or to reduce travel. We have more than 80 in-person outdoor activities as well as remote and hybrid opportunities within several tracks: research, service, disability awareness, leadership, academic enrichment, adventure, art, and health and well-being. And we're proud to share that all of these activities meet one or more of the Teaching and Learning Commons co-curricular records 12 competencies. So if I could first thank all of our faculty partners and PIs and postdocs and graduate students who are hosting an undergraduate participate in a research experience. I want a special thank you for that. And I'd like to ask, please, our faculty and staff partners on this town hall today to please consider encouraging your students to stay with us in beautiful San Diego for spring break. Thank you so much for the chance to highlight this collaborative effort.
Well, thank you, Vice Chancellor Satterland. And if I may ask, could you stay on with me through the final poll question?
Sure.
So as we further consider the challenge of the past year, we'd like to ask a follow-up on to the last poll question related to the communication surrounding the COVID-19 crisis. You can see it on your screen now. And the question is, how can the university help people stay connected during this time? And this is a multiple choice with including more of these return to learn town halls, more executive vice chancellor newsletters, communication, more communication from the academic divisions, or more communication from departments, and finally, other. And while people are making their selections, I'd like to ask you, Vice Chancellor Satterland, what have we learned this year about communicating with our students?
Well, I think like all of us, students would like clear and honest, concise, and timely communication with a feedback loop. They'd like content to be relevant and engaging and creative. And I think our efforts have been most impactful when we've co-created our social media, YouTube videos, and written communication with our students. And I think also receiving information when appropriate with a bit of humor, and then of course, useful resources. And again, I think we've learned that our communication needs to be more timely and more easily digestible for students who are busy working and studying and caring for others and leading and serving.
All right, thank you for that. We're ready for the results from our last poll question. And we can see a broad distribution. So once again, we appreciate this feedback and we're gonna take it into account as we look forward to moving forward in this communications effort. So next we're gonna hear from Vice Chancellor for Research, Sandy Brown, and she's gonna tell us about the updates on the research ramp up. Vice Chancellor Brown.
Excellent, thank you so much, Dr. Continetti. To highlight for everyone, we already have over 6,400 people on campus conducting research every day. And our researchers have on their approved research personnel plans, approximately 8,000 people. So there are extra people that can be added when we have the opportunity to do that. You can see that the vast majority of these individuals are in about 20 buildings across campus, but increasingly so in many more buildings as we open up for more engagement in a safe fashion. The pie chart on the left shows that we have quite a diversity of people already on campus, ranging from the principal investigators or the lead investigators for those projects, other academic personnel and non-academic staff, but also undergraduates, graduate students, and our postdoctoral students and fellows. So it's quite an array of individuals that are already on board on campus, and we are all ready to ramp up even more to the extent that we can. I'm gonna talk with you a little bit about that. If I could have the next slide, please. Next slide, please. Thank you. So while the county is not changing out of its purple designation, at least for a couple of weeks, what we want to do is to be well prepared for any increase in on-site activity and do what we can on campus to immediately today increase the productivity of the labs, because we do know that working like this for over a year has really impacted the productivity of the labs, the opportunities for our undergrads, grads, and postdocs as well. So we will, of course, continue with the CDC guidelines, you know, this 6 feet distancing between people, wearing masks, even for those who are vaccinated, by the way. Continue with hand washing sanitation requirements for each of the sites that have already been agreed upon and approved by EHS and the department chairs and the deans. But what we can do now is to be sure that we do two things. One, make sure that if you're an investigator who has a research ramp up plan, you have everybody listed in your team on that plan in the appropriate phase that you prioritize them. So for example, if we were to be able to go to the next phase, we want to be sure that you have all the individuals listed there that you would want to have to come into the laboratory. And I want to encourage faculty to, while we have to stay at that 25% limit for your entire team, whatever that 25% of that is, think about scheduling. Think about ways that you might be able to have more people in at different times so that you can get more done. And this comes, this includes now our allowance of students that can be added to the plans. Just by way of reminder, currently, that capacity number is clearly independent of the vaccine status, because we were at zero for a portion of time. Now we're all the way up almost 50% on campus, and the county still holds us to that 25% limit. So how can we increase what we do now and be ready for the big change? The next slide, I'll share that with you. First of all, I encourage people to update their ramp up plans, make sure that everybody that you want to have come onto campus at some time when your program's up and rolling again, you have them listed in the appropriate place, the red, orange, yellow, or green phase. Students can be added now. We had restrictions before. Now students can be added. But again, remembering that we have to maintain a certain cap, or they need to be complying with the training protocols that are on the Research Ramp-Up website. We still think that we need to prioritize the people on campus, our faculty, staff, and students, as opposed to outside volunteers. And so we're going to continue that restriction until we get an opportunity from the county to increase the on-site activity at a higher level. If you don't have a plan yet, a research ramp-up plan, please go ahead and fill one out and just go online at the research ramp-up site. Remember that if it's a brand new plan, then it will go through your department chair and your dean for a review before you can officially bring people onto campus. In some cases, if you're asking for something that's outside our normal bounds, then it'll need an EH&S review, but that would be determined for you. So we don't want people to bring a larger number on at any site, but we certainly want people to be thinking about using all the time that's available so that we can maximize the activity that we have on campus. And as soon as we get the go-ahead from the county that we could increase the density, you'll be ready to do that, and we can do that with the turn of a switch. This is just where you can, I should remind you, we'll have a research ramp-up town hall on the 25th. And this is where you can get information and fill out your research ramp-up materials. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Vice Chancellor Brown, for your leadership in getting our research enterprise back on track. It's been so important, such an important part of our university. Now it is time to move on to the question and answer segment. So I invite all of our panelists, including Associate Vice Chancellor Carlos Jensen, Associate Dean Judy Kim, Senior AVC Research Miroslav Kurstich, and Dean John Moore, to turn on their videos. We'll follow the same format as we have previously. So during registration, attendees had an opportunity to submit questions for the panelists to answer. We've selected some of the most popular questions for the panel today. If you have a question now, of course, please use the Q&A window to submit additional questions during the session, and our panelists will do their best to provide answers. Due to time limitations, we may not be able to get to all of your questions. However, we will do our best to post the answers in the FAQ at the returntolearn.ucsd.edu website, as we have before. So the first question today actually is for Vice Chancellor Brown. And the question is, with the recent changes in the California tiers, has there been any change in the guidance for the number of people allowed in the labs?
Oh, this is a wonderful question because we're all ready to increase the on-site activity. The CDC has changed their guidelines, but my understanding is that the state has classified our county, along with the county regions, as remaining in the purple tier. So we can't increase the percentage of people that we have on campus at any time. But what you can do is you can think about, could I structure things in a different way so I could bring some people on at certain times and others at other times, includes evenings, weekend times, morning, afternoon shifts, day shifts, that kind of thing. And we really do encourage you to do that because we are expecting that within the next few weeks, we'll be able to increase the overall volume of people that we have in the laboratories and the research settings at any time. Just two reminders, staff who can work at home should continue to do that, and no large meetings. All meetings are done via Zoom.
Thank you. Thank you, Vice Chancellor Brown. I see that Dean Jim McCarrow has joined us. He's the co-chair of the Research Continuity Task Force. So welcome, Dean McCarrow. And the next question is for EVC Simmons, and that is, how will the COVID-19 protocols influence in-person teaching in the fall? For instance, will group work be okay with masks?
Okay, so we will follow the scientific evidence and the county guidelines and state guidelines, of course, in whatever we do in the fall. So if we're in the situation that our experts, Dr. Schooley and Dr. Martin, are predicting as our best case, where we're able to teach in person with normal classroom capacity, in that case, just as attending a class session would be okay in person, though we'll likely still be wearing masks, then yes, group work would also be okay wearing masks. That is where we are hoping to be. That's where we're planning to be. Of course, we will watch what the actual science is telling us at the time, and if we have to pull back from that, we will. Carlos, do you have any additional detail on that one?
I think that's beautifully encapsulated.
All right, thank you. The next question will also be for you, EVC Simmons. Will students be expected to be vaccinated prior to returning to campus in the fall? If not, can we maintain flexibility for courses?
So let me start with the first question, which you could interpret two different ways. One is, do we expect that students will have had the opportunity to get vaccinated before the fall? And what we've been hearing from our medical and public health experts is, yes, we do expect that before the fall, all adults, including our students, will have had the opportunity to get vaccinated. An alternative way to view the question is, will the University of California mandate that students must have the vaccine before coming back? That we do not know at this time, partly because we don't know when the vaccines might attain a more normal status. Right now, they're approved under an emergency use authorization, where it's not clear if the University of California would mandate anybody having a vaccine under that level of authorization. So that one we don't know. We're going to have to stay tuned. Can we maintain flexibility for courses? We'll certainly be maintaining flexibility, and we will do whatever the science and the public health guidelines say. Chip, Natasha, anything you would want to add?
No, I think that's well said. I think these vaccines are among the best we have. They're incredibly effective, and they seem to be incredibly safe. We require other vaccines for students that aren't as effective. They are safe, but they're not as effective. And this disease is a bad disease, so it's hard to fathom why we wouldn't include this in the same kind of group of vaccines we do for congregate living in other settings like military barracks and colleges and so forth. So I hope the university moves in that direction with appropriate exemptions for the people who have a reason to have them, but I think it's too early to know. I think these are vaccines that are so good people should want to have them rather than try to figure out how not to get them myself.
All right, thank you. And turning to you again, Dr. Schooley, should we continue to get weekly COVID testing after being vaccinated with the first dose or the second dose?
We've been looking at the frequency of shedding after vaccination, and both here in among our healthcare workers, where the vaccines got out of the gates a little bit earlier, and other manuscripts and things I've seen have been looking at that as well in other settings. And what you see is that for the first couple of weeks, people continue to shed virus, and these are people who got infected before they got vaccinated, with the incubation period being what it is. And then as the immunity from the vaccines begins to ramp up, the number of people shedding virus, and in the studies that have looked at it, the amount of virus they shed declined steadily. So that although people will occasionally shed virus, they shed it for a shorter period of time and at lower levels. With that in mind, I think that what we're going to be seeing is less and less need to do asymptomatic screening at the frequency we've been doing it. Dr. Martin is doing some mathematical modeling kind of as we speak, probably parallel processing this meeting to try to get an idea about the best plan for the fall. Let me turn it over to her and see what her thoughts are about those considerations.
Yeah, that's just to say that that's something that we are working on right now in terms of thinking about how vaccination can help inform our adaptive strategy. We always set out to have an adaptive strategy to change our approach as both the epidemiological circumstances as well as other circumstances like vaccination changes. So we are currently rerunning the models to try and understand how we can adapt that approach most effectively in the coming weeks and months.
I'd like to go back to you, Chip. What does the evidence say about the likelihood of transmitting COVID-19 once you're fully vaccinated?
We think it's much, much lower based on how much virus is transmitted or is shed, and based on the data that were generated during the epidemic itself, looking at transmission in settings in which ideas about viral shedding were known. There is a study that actually is being proposed to be done here on this campus, among other places, among college students, to look at that. Dr. Susan Little, who led the two studies down at the Antiviral Research Center, is going to present to the Campus Operations Group tomorrow a study that the NIH would like us to consider, in which about 500 of our students would be offered the Moderna vaccination, and we would then follow their contacts to see if their acquisition of virus is lower than matched contacts who aren't vaccinated. Once the other students are eligible for vaccination, they would be vaccinated. So this would be basically an opportunity to be vaccinated early in the randomization and to look at this question formally. As a scientist, I think the work needs to be done. If I were somebody who spent time at Del Mar, I would bet that the vaccines are going to have a major effect on transmission.
Excellent. Well, if you'll bear with me, because obviously vaccine questions are high on people's minds at this time. So the question is, would it be safe to receive the Johnson & Johnson vaccine after receiving Pfizer? Johnson & Johnson is better against the new variants, so we could mix the vaccines, no?
No, I mean, not the safety part, but it's not better than the other vaccines against the new strains. What I think we're going to end up doing is having to tweak the vaccines and offer boosters as the variants continue to evolve away from our collective immune response and away from the pressure induced by vaccines in the population. I think that we are going to be mixing and matching these vaccines. Some of the experience with adenovirus-based vaccines like the Johnson & Johnson vaccine have been that you can't repetitively boost with them because you develop immunity to the adenovirus as well as to the carrier virus that you're trying to vaccinate against. And if you keep using the same adenovirus, you don't respond to the other vaccine. So I suspect we're going to see people getting vaccinated first with some people with the an adenovirus-based vaccine followed by an RNA-based vaccine. And those kinds of studies are on the books right now.
Excellent. Thank you for that information. Now I'd like to go to Associate Vice Chancellor Jensen. Carlos, can you provide some information about summer classes and on-campus programs?
Sure. So for the spring and this summer, we're hoping to be in the red tier, which means 25% occupancy in the classes, 6-foot distancing, the same kind of protocols that we had in place in the fall. For summer, through spring and summer, we have the dispensation from Senate to provide remote classes without special permission. And so what we're expecting to see over the summer, especially, is the same kind of shift to predominantly remote teaching. We had a lot of students who took great advantage of that. It was a great way for them to stay engaged, to either catch up or get ahead of their studies, and they responded phenomenally to those offerings. In terms of other on-campus programs, we're going to be very cautious about events. There's not going to be any events for students that are not our own or outside populations, but we do expect to be able to have some on-campus activity, including classes, especially using the outdoor classrooms. They're still going to be available, and some bridge and onboarding programs as we get closer to fall. EVC Simmons, do you have anything that you want to add to that?
No, I think the only thing that occurs to me is that there's one kind of activity that's a little bit exceptional, which is the following. So AVC Jensen was describing activities for our own matriculated students or our own students who are about to matriculate with us in the fall. So classes or bridge programs. There's another small segment of programs that are long enough that people have a chance to move here and settle in and be part of the whole testing program and everything. And these are our very small, but very influential summer REU programs. And the faculty have asked whether there's any way to be able to hold them in person. Each one has maybe a dozen students. And they really would be part of the faculty PI's research ramp up plans, and there'd be time to really plan everything carefully. So we are setting up a mechanism to enable our REU programs that are more than 7 weeks in length to be able to still happen. That's the only special thing we have going on in summer. Again, that's a total of maybe 100 students maximum, but we thought those were pretty important for faculty research and outreach efforts.
Thank you, thank you. I noticed Vice Chancellor Satterlin that a link to a spring break webpage was posted. Can you say a little bit about what we can find there?
Oh, absolutely. So I wanted to share the link to our spring break calendar, which is ever evolving. I met with the Spring Break Collective right before joining the town hall, and there are a number of events and programs, particularly related to service and adventure, that are in the process of being added. I also wanted to share that all of our programs and services have been developed with our disabled students in mind, and captioning, as well as our appropriate accommodations will be made so all of our students can participate.
Excellent. Thank you. Dr. Martin, here's a one that came in live. So when you are reporting the percent of employees and students vaccinated, are you including people who've been vaccinated outside of the UC system? And as a follow-on, could that question be asked in our daily symptom survey until we are vaccinated as a way of gathering further data?
Thanks, Bob. So my understanding is that the current coverage estimates are just reporting vaccines that have been received here. But I believe that the campus IT, the people working in campus IT are trying to investigate whether they could additionally collect data of vaccinations outside the UCSD system. Chip, do you know more about this? Could you comment?
Yeah, I don't know at the individual level how much they know about people vaccinated outside the UCSD system because of privacy issues in terms of employees. We know aggregate numbers of people that have been vaccinated among our own staff, but I don't know that people who are vaccinated elsewhere are reported to us as having been vaccinated elsewhere. If Chris Longhurst were here, we could ask him, but we'll have to ask the two that you have who are giving you speculative answers.
Okay, well, you can take that back to them later. Now, EVC Simmons and EVC Jensen, we talked about the fall and summer, but of course, athletics are an important part of the university. And I was wondering, EVC Simmons, can you give us an update on the status of sporting events?
Well, in fact, I'm going to turn this over to VCSA Satterlin, who oversees athletics and recreation both. Allison.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. So we have a very rigorous return to sport plan that was developed in partnership with Dr. Socha and Dr. Schooley and Dr. Martin. We're continuing, of course, within the expectations of the conference and also the county. We will be examining some of the recent CDC guidelines and state guidelines around the potential for fans to join outdoor sporting events, but we are just at the beginning stage of assessing that. And of course, it'll come to our Return to Learn Committee and to Cabinet and to campus operations at the appropriate time. But in the meantime, our scholar athletes continue to participate with our Division I scholar partners from scholar athletes from across the state. And I understand that we're undefeated in women's basketball in D1, noting, of course, there have been two games thus far, but we'll take it.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for that. We have another live question for Chip, Dr. Schooley. Do we have an idea that all undergrads living on campus can get vaccinated? Is that's part of the plan?
It will be ultimately part of the plan. Right now, undergraduates who have jobs in teaching and graduate students who have jobs in teaching are eligible under the state guidelines. Students per se are not eligible. We anticipate that when we move to tier two, which is the one after the one we're going to next week, that students will be part of that and will be able to vaccinate all the students on campus who wish to be vaccinated.
Thank you. Thank you. So, yeah, I think we've had a good round table here and answered a lot of questions about the vaccine and other aspects of our response, and I think we will bring this town hall to a close. So thank you to everyone for your questions. And we will be following up with the any other written questions that came in by updating the FAQ that is on the Return to Learn website and posting a recording of this town hall as well. I want to thank the presenters and our guests for sharing their time and information with us today. And I thank you, the faculty of UC San Diego, for attending, taking the time, and working together as a community to help bring us through these unprecedented times. Also, we encourage you to complete the post-event survey that you will receive shortly to help us continue to improve our means of communication during this stressful period. And we appreciate your participation in the polling as well, and that we'll take that into account as we just make decisions on how to work on communication going forward. So this concludes the Return to Learn Faculty Town Hall. The next town hall will be held Tuesday, March 23rd at 11 a.m. for staff. And we heard from Vice Chancellor Brown that the Return to Research Faculty Town Hall is on the 25th. So thank you, take care, stay safe, and I look forward to seeing you all on campus again soon. Thank you, bye.